So, yeah, good morning also from my side. We will start with network and security monitoring. I will give an overview, a few definitions, what kinds of network monitoring do exist, how could that look like. I will talk about net flows, and then we will speak about intrusion detection. Especially, we will speak about SIEG, that is one IDS. And in the end, I will talk about honeypots, and we will close with a summary. So, what is this all about? We want to build secure IT systems, and doing that, there are usually four steps that we do over and over again. When we design the system, we start with prevention. That could mean that we include firewalls in our system architecture. Additionally, we could add intrusion detection systems for detection of certain events. That could also include honeypots to learn more about attackers. And again, the reaction could lead to new firewall rules. And yeah, this is a circle. We do that over again, over and over again. The system is never finished, and we are done because yeah, attackers are evolving and our systems are changing, so we have to change our firewalls, our intrusion detection systems over and over again. So, we want to deploy network monitoring for what? We want to know who accessed which service, when, where, and how, whose and which resources were used, what is the performance and the quality of service of our system, and which protocols and services are being used. We want to have this information for intrusion detection and fault management. We want to have data about our system and our services in general, about the reachability, about the availability. We could use the data for capacity planning and for performance monitoring and optimizations. And in the end, we could also generate statistics for accounting and metering. So the goal is to collect useful information from all the various parts of the network. That includes all servers, all client machines, yeah, everything that is running. And we could manage the network based on the data that we are collecting. So usually there are four steps. We first configure devices in a way that they generate, for example, flow accounting records, so-called flow records that include or that show data about network streams. Then we export all data from the different devices to a single centralized collector or multiple centralized collectors. And then yeah, we save the data, and later on we can analyze the flows. That could look like this. We have a router in the middle. There are multiple machines, and our flow analyzer receives a copy of every single network packet that requires a mirror port. And that is, of course, resource intensive because we are doubling the traffic. And yeah, we will use all packets to generate our flow records and save them in the flow collector. It could also be realized like this. Here we have a router that is a flow collector at the same time, and users can send queries to the flow collector to learn more about the network traffic. There are lots of different flow exporting protocols by the different vendors of routers, basically. So there's the NetFlow by Cisco, there's JFlow by Juniper, NetStream by Huawei, and so on. Those protocols are different, but in the end, they tell the same. I will focus on NetFlow for the moment. In NetFlow, you have the source IP address, destination IP address, source port, destination port, the layer 3 protocol, TOS byte, type of service byte, and the interface where the NetFlow was recorded. So there's no actual data included, it's just meter information about the traffic. And this data can be used to answer the questions regarding IP traffic, who did what, and where, and when, and how. So which user is downloading most torrents for research, for example, could be answered. Or which is the most commonly used protocol in my network. Also, this data can be used to identify anomalies and attacks. And we can generate more or less nice viewing dashboards and other types of visualization. So we can process the data and visualize them in a user-friendly format. And what we cannot achieve by NetFlow monitoring is that we save a copy of the data. We don't have the actual data that were transferred, we only have the metadata of the network traffic. So what does this look like? Here's a NetFlow example. We see the source port, source IP address, destination IP address, destination port. We see the protocol number and the bytes or packets per second. And here is an example that shows the potential DOS attacks on a single router. And DOS attacks have in common that packets, you see that here on the right side, have usually the same size, and we have lots of different source IP addresses that are targeting the same destination IP address. So when you are on the command line of your router, usually you could show all flows that are to one destination. Here's another example that shows the flows to one single destination. And now you could use those data to look for known attack signatures. For example, if we know there's an attack spreading that uses UDP port 666, we could ask the router to show all flows that include the certain port UDP 666. But of course, that's no monitoring yet, because that's a very manual way of investigating. We want to automate things. Next, I will show you a few dashboards, different products that show visualizations of NetFlow data. Those collectors receive flow records from different exporters. They could analyze the records to produce sensible information, and they present data in a more user-friendly way. This picture shows the tool Scrutinizer. On the left, you see the main path in your network. In the center, you see the most common protocols in your network, like HTTP, TCP, HTTPS. And all tools have more or less the same features in common. So here's the tool Manage Engine. It does more or less the same. I can show the most active devices, Such a tool could also visualize the recent alarms, or it could show the disk volumes on certain machines that are with most disk usage, and it could also present devices by CPU utilization. So some of these tools do not focus on NetFlow, but also include all other kinds of performance information. And yeah, here's just yet another tool which shows only NetFlow data. And for example, on the right, you can see the top 10 applications for the last hour in our network. So let's assume that we are collecting lots of data in our network, but that is no monitoring yet. So monitoring is more than collecting data. So we want to look into firewalls, intrusion detection systems, honeypots, and maybe we would like to add new firewall rules based on the detected attacks. If we combine firewalls and intrusion detection systems, we will have an intrusion prevention system. So an intelligent intrusion detection system could detect attacks and generate new firewall rules on its own in order to prevent attacks. So again, we want an overall overview about all our computer systems and the communication infrastructure. We have to keep in mind that full protection is usually not possible. That means we have to assume that at some point of time, the attacker will be in our network. And then monitoring could be useful as well, because we could learn what the attacker did in the network afterwards, after we noticed that he's inside our network. So we want to learn which devices did the attacker infect and how. So what can we achieve by intrusion detection? We can detect attacks and attackers as well, and we want or could detect some types of system misuse. That includes misuse by legitimate users, the aforementioned downloading of torrents for research use, for example, could easily be detected by intrusion detection and monitoring systems. Again, the intrusion detection system is only a fraction of the detection step. So detecting attacks makes only sense if there are any consequences. The goals could be to limit the damage. I mean, if we prevent or stop an attack, of course, there will be less damage than if we ignore the attack. We could learn out of an attack for the future to improve our preventive measures, and we could also learn about other potential attackers. And again, also the data could help the police. If we collect more data, we can probably hand over more data about the attacker to the police, and it could happen that the police is then able to arrest them. So first, we have a stream of events here on the left. These are, for example, NetFlow data or all kinds of log data from the different systems. They will be gathered in a central terminal or monitoring system, and attached to the monitoring system is the system helps managing IT security incidents. So if you think about the dashboards in the beginning, these dashboards might be useful to visualize things, but if there is an attack on your network, you want to make sure that there is an adequate reaction. So your system should create an event, and your system should make sure that someone is actually reacting on this event. So the security information event management system, SIEM, will generate a ticket, for example, and it will remind you if you don't take care of this ticket that was generated. And yeah, depending on the attack, there could also be an automatic reaction, but that depends on the attack. So we could record all security relevant events from a computer system that includes opening of files or creation of new administrator users, execution of programs, or access violations and failed password verification events. From a network perspective, connection establishment and release could be interesting. Also, the number of packets transferred from or to specific systems and ports is something you want to monitor. Because if you notice a change in the number of packets, for example, it could mean that someone is downloading a lot of data. Of course, that could be intended because there's a workshop and a lot of participants are accessing files, but it could also mean that an attacker is downloading your data. And then there are application-specific events that are related to the specific applications in your organization, and they could also indicate some security-relevant activities. All this data are input for our intrusion detection and response mechanisms, and those data require integrity protection, because if we have a monitoring system and someone is attacking our network successfully, we want to avoid that the attacker can disable the monitoring system and delete all the data that we have. So we need to protect the intrusion detection system against the attacker very well. So if our intrusion detection system detects events, that could be a true positive or a false negative, false positive or a true negative. So the intrusion detection system could detect an attack when there is an actual attack, but it could also send an alarm when no attack is ongoing. So we would like to have an intrusion detection system with high accuracy, which means we want a low false positive rate and a low false negative rate. A low false positive rate means we only want to have an alarm when there's an actual attack ongoing. And a false negative, a low false negative rate means we want to catch all attacks that are ongoing. Our system should not report that everything is fine when our system is under attack. So the true positive rate indicates the successful detection of attacks. The false negative rate indicates where attacks were not detected. True negative rate is about events that the true negative rate is about events that were successfully labeled as normal events, and the false positive rate is about the false alarms. Then there are further requirements. The system should be easy to integrate into our system and network. It should be easy to configure and maintain the system. It should be autonomous and fault tolerant. The resource requirements should be as low as possible, and we would like to have some kind of self-protection so that the IDS itself cannot easily be deactivated by an attacker. There are different intrusion detection systems on the market, and they differ in scope, architecture, and detection mechanism. The scope could be host-based, so the intrusion detection system runs on certain hosts on your network and analyzes the system events. Then your intrusion detection system could be network-based, which means it analyzes all your communication data, usually IP packets. And of course, it is also possible to combine those types in a hybrid IDS. The host-based IDS works on operating system logs, application logs, and all data include timestamps, but that holds for all kinds of intrusion detection systems. And using a host-based IDS, we can detect attackers by insiders, by modification of files or illegal access to files, or a password that was typed in wrong too often, or we can learn about the installation of rootkits on our machines. The problem is, such a system has to be installed on every single system in our network. It produces a lot of information, and probably 99% of those information are not relevant to us. Often there is no real-time analysis, and it's hard to manage if you have a large number of systems. A nice example for a host monitoring system is OS Query. This is an open source host-based intrusion detection system, and this system provides an SQL interface to the log files on our system. So we could define SQL-style queries to query the data that are on our operating systems. It's fast. The system is used in large companies, which means it's battle-tested, and it's open source. So you can download it legally for free and use it in your organization. This system can monitor the running processes, it can monitor the logged in users, password changes, or it could tell you about new USB devices in your system and about new firewall exceptions that are created and about the listening ports where your different services are running. This OS Query IDS has a high performance. It could run everywhere independent of the operating system software or hardware configuration. It has a host monitoring daemon that allows to schedule queries across your entire infrastructure, which means you could query all hosts in your network for, let's say, every 5 minutes. And it also takes care of aggregating the results over time, and it generates logs that indicate state changes in the infrastructure. So OS Query could be a framework, or is a framework, for intrusion detection, but you can also use it to monitor your infrastructure reliability, and you could use it for compliance monitoring. But in the end, OS Query is only about monitoring. There is no intrusion detection capability on its own. So OS Query is only collecting the data. You need to attach something in order to detect attacks. Yeah, network IDS are different. They work provided by the information They work on the information provided by the network. They mainly sniff packets on the network layer. And existing systems use a combination of signature detection, protocol decoding, and statistical anomaly analysis. They can detect denial of service attacks, invalid packets, attacks on the application layer, DDoS attacks, spoofing attacks, port scans. And they are often used on network hubs to monitor a segment of the network. So if you have a central uplink to the internet, that would be a point where you could attach the network intrusion detection system. So here you see our network. We are connected to the internet. On the bottom you see our local area network, and then we have a demilitarized zone, the DMZ, which holds our web servers and email servers. And in the DMZ on the router or on the switch, we could configure a port in a way that the switch forwards all data to a monitoring port where the data are analyzed by the network-based intrusion detection system. And at the gateway to the internet, we could install another probe that monitors all incoming traffic for high load or a high rate of false alarms. And here we could measure any attack attempts from the outside. The probe in the DMZ monitors all traffic to and from the DMZ. However, of course, it can only detect attacks on these devices, but the IDS that runs in the DMZ will not care about attacks that target the local area network, which means we need another probe monitor that could work in the local area network and will detect attacks from the inside, for example, from compromised devices, if you allow to bring your own devices. In the end, you want to combine all those different systems in a central IDS. Most network IDS support this kind of architecture. So here we have a segmented network. If one part of the network is infected, it won't affect the full network of the company. And we don't need an intrusion detection system in every single host. It's enough to have a probe in the different segments of the network, and all data are being forwarded to the central IDS or to the central SIEM that analyzes all data. So then in the beginning I said there are different types of IDS. They could be host-based, network-based, or hybrid, and then there are different architectures. The IDS could be centralized, hierarchical, or distributed. So there are IDS that have a very central node. There are IDSs that analyze data and move data from the bottom to the top, and then there are distributed approaches where you have multiple intrusion detection systems, all are equal, and the question here is how you would correlate alerts in a collaborative scenario, because if you have an attack on your network, the attack will show up in multiple intrusion detection systems at the same time, and you have to correlate those alerts somehow. That is usually easier in centralized approaches. And then the intrusion detection systems differ in the detection mechanism. The mechanism could be signature-based. That means you know what is malicious, and based on that you generate signatures or you download signatures from the vendor of the IDS. That is what usually antivirus software does as well. Then there are policy-based detection mechanisms. That is the other way around. You know what is allowed. You define in the IDS what is allowed. For example, you only allow a low rate of traffic on port 443 HTTPS, and everything else is suspicious. Or you could combine the first and the second approach. And then there is an anomaly-based detection mechanism. You know what is normal, or at least the intrusion detection system knows what is normal, and it will report when there are changes from the normal state. With signature-based detection, the basic idea is that some attack patterns can easily be described with signatures, and the IDS simply analyzes if a network event contains a known attack signature. That could be for a web server, a regular expression, for example, that looks for SQL injections. That's a typical example for an attack signature-based mechanism. So signature-based detection is good for analyzing known vulnerabilities and past attacks that have been recorded. The attack signatures have to be specified based on identified knowledge. So somehow we need to generate those rules that describe the attacks. You don't have to do everything on your own, because of course there are lots of well-known attacks that lead to well-known signatures that you could use in order to detect standard attacks. And most IDS have an own specification that you could use to specify your own rules additionally. The drawbacks are that you need knowledge about the potential attacks. Then your signature database needs to be updated. That's the same with antivirus systems. And some systems lead to a high rate of false negative if the signature database is not up to date. One example for signature-based IDS is Snort. I think it's also open source. It's an IDS and intrusion prevention system. It analyzes IP packets in real time, and it's mainly signature-based. So you need to define rules before you could use the system. And here's an example for a rule that would detect all IP packets. Of course, that's no useful rule if you want to detect attacks. That's just an example to show how one would configure such rules. So here we say we would like to have an alert for IP packets independent of the source IP address and source port, and independent of the destination IP and destination port. And if there's a match, we want to show the message IP packet detected. Different are policy-based detection mechanisms. We specify what is allowed, and we do not specify what is forbidden. But most policy-based detection systems could do both. If there's a violation, there will be an alert. In that way, it's similar to a firewall. The drawback is, of course, you can only detect what you configured. And again, you need expert knowledge. This time, you need expert knowledge of the system to be protected, because you have to describe what is allowed in your system. So how would such a system work? I will speak about the example Zeek. Zeek is formerly known as Bro. That is an open source network-based intrusion detection system. So we have the network. The network generates a stream of packets. Zeek uses libpcap. Using libpcap, we can filter the packet stream for certain ports and protocols. Then there's the Zeek event engine that leads to a stream of events. So I could generate a log file that shows all connections that are ongoing at the moment. And on top of that is the policy script interpreter. Here I can define my policies that describe what is allowed in my network and what is forbidden. And then Zeek generates in real time notifications and writes the records to disk. Zeek is primary network monitoring tool. It can be used for traffic analysis, but you could also configure it in a way that it becomes a powerful intrusion detection system. Zeek focuses on application level semantic analysis. So the policy-based detection is usually on protocols, and we can easily track information over time. And Zeek can act as dynamic and intelligent firewall, which means if we detect certain attacks in our network, Zeek itself can create rules that block further traffic from certain IPs, for example. So the architecture is as follows. Zeek operates often on a mirror port as well, or on a tap device. On top of that happens packet processing and using a special programming language and lots of standard libraries, we can define our policies. And doing so, we could write different types of apps in Zeek. So with Zeek, we can build an intrusion detection system. We can use it for vulnerability management, for file analysis, for traffic management or traffic control, and as well, we could use it for compliance monitoring. So here's an example what you could use Zeek for. In the files.log are information about all the files that were seen by Zeek in our network, and by writing this one line at the bottom, we could analyze the log file and generate this picture, which shows which file types are most common in our network. We could also analyze which software is used by most hosts in our network. Here we can see that, for example, Google update, Windows update, yeah, most services are used by the same number of hosts in our network. Probably all hosts run Chrome, and not so many hosts run the Dropbox desktop client. So what Zeek does is that it generates lots of nice log files. Here the software.log file, and further analysis is needed in order to actually learn about attacks. Zeek provides only the first step. It provides all the data that you need in order to detect attacks. Yeah, finally, there are anomaly-based detection systems. The basic idea is you want to detect behavior that differs significantly from normal use. users often have certain habits in their system usage, like login times or the amount of file system usage usually doesn't change overnight. Also, users often execute the same programs, access the same files, and using anomaly-based detection, you could detect changes here. So the assumption is that the normal user behavior can be described by statistics that requires a learning phase. You need to specify what is normal user behavior, and most approaches require labeled data. That means for your learning step, for your learning phase, you need to know which part of the log files that you have actually describe normal behavior and which parts of the log files that you analyze are attacks. And in the analysis step, the system compares the recorded events with a reference profile of normal behavior. The advantage is attack scenarios do not have to be defined before you use the system, and this approach can, in principle, be used to detect unknown attacks as well. A generic anomaly detection system would look like this. You have the network, and as said before, you have multiple probes in the network that feed data into a central processing system, and then there are events with and without attacks. The events without attacks you could use to feed your modeling subsystem, which derives a model that describes the normal user behavior. This model is then used in the analysis subsystem in order to detect behavior that is not normal, and based on the detected events, you could decide if you want to react on that or if you want to ignore whatever happened. So that is about defining normal user behavior, including every possible normal behavior is difficult. Often it's not that clear where normal behavior ends and anomalous behavior starts. And so there's always the chance of false positive and false negatives. Also, attackers could adapt to this kind of detection. The attacker's behavior could be dynamic, and attackers often adapt themselves to make the anomalous observation appear normal. So an intelligent attacker would not download all files in one night, because you would notice that the attacker could decide to download your files over the course of multiple weeks, for example. And that way, you probably won't notice that someone is downloading all the files of your network. And as with the systems before, the system is not static. The normal behavior changes over time, and you have to reconfigure your system from time to time. What is normal differs from application to application, and applying one technique that was developed in one domain may not work in another domain. So if you have certain rules from the literature department of your university, you can probably not use the same rules for the computer science department, because the user behavior is completely different. Another challenge is the availability of labeled data. So it's expensive in terms of time and money to gather data and label them yourself. You need human experts that now about the normal behavior in your network. And then there's noise in the data. The noise could be similar to the actual anomalies, and it's not easy to distinguish between noise and anomalies in order to remove the noise in the data. And finally, we are collecting user-specific usage patterns that could violate the user's privacy, and the data that we are collecting will probably show work-related or personal habits. So if we look at our data, we will easily see who arrives late at work every day. Or who uses his breaks to consume all the fun pages on the internet. So for anomaly-based detection, in case you have the data that describe normal behavior, you could use a nearest neighbor approach in order to detect anomalies, so for example, K nearest neighbors. And this approach is interesting because that is some kind of unsupervised learning. The approach adapts to different data only by defining an appropriate distance measure. However, the performance could be worse because it relies on a good distance measure, and depending on the nature of your data, you could have a high false positive rate. With classification-based anomaly detection, you have a training and testing phase. For example, if you use neural networks, Bayesian networks, support vector machines, you have a training phase, testing phase, and then you can actually use the system. Some systems have a pre-compiled model, so the testing phase is short. However, those systems rely on the availability of accurate labels that describe normal user behavior, which is often not possible. And more methods include clustering-based approaches, or more statistics, information theoretic, or spectral anomaly detection. So another challenge with all IDSs is that we have a sheer amount of log data, so significant storage capacities are required. If we log data on all systems in our network, that could easily lead to multiple terabytes of log data per month, and we want to have an automated processing of all the data because of this amount of log data. Nobody wants to do that by hand. And additionally, we could decide which log data do we need for, let's say, 1 month, and which log data are that important for our organization that we want to save them for, let's say, 1 year. We have to decide where we want to store the log data. If you have a central log server, data must be transferred to this server, which means we need network capacity. And if we store the data on the system itself, we need resources of the system. So we have to decide, do we want to use a central server, then we need the network capacity, otherwise we could save the data on the systems itself, but then we need enough free resources on the systems. And we want to protect the audit data, because if a system gets compromised, the audit data on it may get compromised as well. And another challenge or problem is we have to decide, as mentioned before, which information is actually relevant to us. If you collect all possible log data, there's only a low percentage of useful information. So 99% of the log data that you are collecting are probably not of interest to you. Then there's the data protection privacy problem. In the log data are user IDs. There are further elements that could indirectly or partly identify users, like names of directories, or file names, or program names. And then there are further identifying elements like host types, times, actions, access rights, and so on, which means the data that you collect using your IDS may violate the privacy of users. So the collected information might be abused if your system is not secured properly. You could circumvent this problem in part by pseudonymous audits, which means you do not log the actual usernames, but use pseudonyms in order to ensure the privacy of the users, and you have to ensure that the pseudonyms can only be mapped to the user IDs upon incident detection. So if you look at the log data, you won't notice certain users. Only in the case of an actual event, you are able to read the user's name in order to contact the user and identify the right system. Then the efficiency of the analysis is limited, of course. Most IDS are centralized, so you won't notice events that are far away from this central part of the network, and this central element, the central IDS, might be a performance bottleneck, because all log data have to be transported over the network to this single point in the network, and this could lead to insufficient efficiency, especially concerning sophisticated attacks and attacks that involve multiple parallel actions. And another thing that will annoy you or the people who are using the IDS then is the high number of false positives. So in some organizations that are not too large, you could easily have 10,000 of false positives a month. That's way too much. You have to adjust your rules then. And a possible potential countermeasure is alert correlation. So you won't create an alert for every single reported incident. You will first collect few incidents and try to correlate them. And only when a certain threshold is crossed, you will generate an actual alert. Another challenge, we have to protect the system against insider attacks, and we need strategies to cope with high load. That is a mistake, I already said that. And another challenge is the cooperation between multiple IDS. So I could have a host-based intrusion detection system, I could have a network based intrusion detection system, and usually those systems will not speak to each other, and that way I do not use all the information that I have. But there are some systems that you could use together. For example, you could use OS query to collect information on all the hosts on the network. And then you could use Zeek to collect network information. And those those information can be combined because there is an OS query to Zeek interface. So the OS query data can be fed into the Zeek IDS. And finally, distributed attacks may produce many alerts in many probes across the network, and those alerts could belong to the same attack. For example, when there's a distributed port scan or worm spreading or a DDoS attack. So again, you want to have some kind of alert correlation. If you run multiple intrusion detection systems, you need cooperation between those. To summarize this part, there are different types of intrusion detection systems. Some use host-based sensors, others use network-based sensors. Detection mechanisms could be signature-based, policy-based, or anomaly-based, and we also have active approaches. The before-mentioned approaches are all passive. We are not interacting with the attacker. We could change that in the future using honeypots. Then there are collaborative intrusion detection systems. They are useful for detection of large-scale and coordinated attacks. It could be useful to know if only my university is under attack or if all universities in the country are under attack. Again, alert correlation is a major challenge here. And the buzzword is threat information sharing. There's, for example, the MISP project. That is an open source platform that can be used to share threat information to others, but you can also use the system to collect threat information from others and use those as signatures in your own intrusion detection systems. And then there are evasion attacks to bypass intrusion detection systems. So if the attacker knows about the signatures that you are using in your organization, he could try to avoid those certain signatures, and using, for example, covered channels, an attacker could also evade anomaly-based detection. We return to this picture. We have the prevention phase, then comes the detection phase. We have talked about intrusion detection, and now we will have a look at honeypots. A honeypot is a security resource whose value lies in being probed, attacked, or compromised. So if we run a honeypot, then that is a special system that is vulnerable, and we are waiting for an attacker to attack our honeypot so that we can learn about the attacker and his goals. You should never use the honeypot as a standalone security mechanism, because an attacker could simply ignore the honeypot and attack your real systems. So first, you would like to have an intrusion detection system, and additionally, you could run one or multiple honeypots in order to learn more about the people who are attacking your network. So, why should you run honeypots? It's fun from a scientific point of view, because you could see in real time what people are doing on your machines. You don't have false positives, so an honeypot is a vulnerable machine. You want people to attack it, and Every single action that takes place on your honeypot is a real attack step. Honeypots are used for research. You could use those for to collect malware samples. You could use those malware samples for further analysis. And honeypots are being used as an early warning system for new threats. There are quite a few advantages. So honeypots are flexible. There are no false positives. It's possible to catch false negatives. And there's usually a low overhead. You just run one additional machine in your local network that is exposed to the public internet. However, the drawback is you only have limited visibility. You learn only about attackers that target that single machine. And of course, the honeypot adds additional attack surface. So on hacker conferences have been interesting talks about people who would attack honeypots and use the honeypot as an entry to the company's system. So because of that, the honeypot should be really secure, separated from the production part of the network. To summarize, intrusion detection systems and honeypots are reactive security tools that can be used to detect attacks. There are different kinds of intrusion detection systems. Zeek is one that can be used for policy-based and anomaly-based IDS. Zeek is a system that can be used for policy-based and anomaly-based detection mechanisms. But it also has a signature component. It's open source and free to use. You want to use the IDS in combination with a firewall in order to have an intrusion prevention system. And the classification mechanisms that you want to use depend on the kind of sensors that you deployed or can deploy in your network, and also depends on the level of distribution. There are, of course, problems and challenges as well. You will see huge amounts of data that have to be processed. The accuracy will be limited, and you will have a large number of false positives in the beginning that hopefully changes over time. You could hurt the user's privacy, and in the end, an IDS does not solve all problems because there are IDS evasion techniques. Honeypots are a good additional component to IDSs, but should never be used alone. It's a purely passive monitoring component, and you nearly have no false positives. Yeah, if you have questions, then there's no time for that.
Any questions?
Yeah. Okay, thank you, Marcus, for your nice presentation. I'm a bit interested in Zeek. So in terms of the efficiency, accuracy, and the detection speed, how is the Zeek compared to the Snort, let's say, in terms of the detection speed and accuracy, efficiency, and so on? Thank you.
So SNORT is mainly a signature-based system. So SNORT is easier to deploy. Of course, here with SNORT, but also with Zeek, you need to define predefined rules. So if you want a basic level of protection, you could use both SNORT or Zeek. But if you want to use more sophisticated detection mechanisms that are, for example, policy-based or anomaly-based, you want to use Zeek. However, you will need more time in order to configure Zeek in a way that suits to your organization.
Yeah, thank you. Mr. Matthias, I'm interested about anomaly-based detection. How do you define the normal? So according to your experience, how long do you monitor something when you decided it is normal or not?
That's a hard question, so that's a topic of current research. It's not easy to define normal. That depends heavily on your organization. So if you have industry processes, it might be enough to monitor your system for 1 hour, and that's the normal stage because your industry process never changes. But with an organization, you will, like in university, you will need more time because in the morning people arrive and they will enter and they will log in into their system, so you will have lots of wrong password attempts in the morning just because the people just arrived and are logging in into their system. But then there are holidays, there are zero logins, so you shouldn't use the holidays for the training phase, holiday phase as training phase. And then it could be that you restarted a system and everyone has to log in again. So again, there will be a high rate of wrong passwords. So yeah, it's not easy to answer this question. It heavily depends on your organization. With universities, it's usually way more than a single day. But you could use different timings for different parts of the system. For systems where users interact, you could use a longer training phase, and for systems where there is no user interaction or not so much, a shorter training phase might be sufficient. Also, you could try a short training phase first, and if you have a high number of false positives, you will try again.
Any other question before we move to the next session? We still have several minutes. No? I'll start with another question. Matthias, I want your comment, perhaps, or maybe you may share some of the best practice in your university. In my experience, governing, or I mean, like monitoring, or creating some policy in the networks for the university is quite challenging due to the very diverse type of user. So usually like university, for example, is not the same like in the company. They are more uniforms kind of self. In the university, it's quite different. Even when we watch this, the YouTube statistics, what the users see something like that or watch, it's quite diverse between one faculty and the other faculty. What is, in my opinions, the anomaly could, how to say, could really rise on that situations. Maybe you may share about the situations in your university.
So I work in the informatics part of the University of Hamburg, but University of Hamburg is large. There are more than 40,000 students. So of course we have the same problems, and from time to time it happens that we want to scan the internet, for example, or that we run a honeypot in our network, and then the German research network shuts our port down because we are doing evil things and they think that our machine is affected. And yeah, then we talk to them, we explain, and then they sometimes create special routes just for us. So now we have a special IP range that we could use for internet scanning, for example, and we will receive the abuse complaints ourselves and have to react on this, and doing so, I guess the computer department is more happy with us now because they have less work, but in the end you will have a basic level that suits most people in your organization, and then yeah, you have to create extra rules for the different needs.
Yes.
So, if you don't have more questions, I will still be around, and I'm happy to answer all the questions that you may have later.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Matthias. I have a question about traffic analyzer on HTTPS and other secure traffic. As we know, is it not possible to intercept the HTTPS traffic, right? Is there any method to analyze this traffic?
There are very few mechanisms that could be used to analyze HTTPS traffic. So if you think about brute force attacks, for example, then you could detect those even though the traffic is encrypted, because you have certain patterns in the traffic. With a brute force attack, you have many same-sized requests in a short time frame, and you will also have same-sized answers of your system. So that is something that you could use as meta information to detect attacks. However, of course, it's no longer possible to circumvent the HTTPS, which means you can no longer use the network-based intrusion detection system, even though there are some techniques that transfer the cryptographic keys from the clients to the central IDS. That way the IDS could still decrypt the traffic. However, the clients need to change the system then. Or you could rely on host-based intrusion detection systems that run on the client. So again, you want both host-based and network-based IDS.
Okay then, if no more questions, we are going to prepare for the next remote session. Thank you very much. Give applause to meanwhile, you can